Welcome back to another video. Different type of video this time. As we can see, I am sat in a 2008 Mark II Renault Megane. And before I start, if you can hear any background noise, it's this fella cutting his grass in the rain. So this video is just going to be short and sweet, a little bit of a story time, and I'll give you an overview of the car. So first, let's start off with, it is a 5-door. Dark red metallic, and it has a 1.6 VVT-i in it with a 5-speed box. So it's got climate control, it's got a half leather interior, it's got dual panoramic roof, it's got an auto electric dimming rear view mirror, got electric windows all around, it's got folding electric wing mirrors, it has also got cruise control, it's got all the creature comforts necessary, it's got auto headlights and all the rest of it. It also comes with 2 keys, logbook, service history, owner's manual. So let's go through some of this. This is what I managed to make the deal with the car with. I'll come back to that later. So to me, as a mechanic, I'm not too fussed on the service history. Some people who are mechanics, some people who aren't mechanics, won't buy a car unless it's got service history. But to me, it's not that big of a deal. If it didn't have service history, it would make a blind bit of difference to me. So it's got evidence of its MOTs, it needed a bulb on that one. It's got your certificate to say it's passed. I'm really not too interested. It's had an oil change there, it's had a brake fluid flush. Really not interested. This one, it's had a flush and an oil change and a wheel alignment. I mean, it's nice to know that it's had a wheel alignment, but as long as it drives in a straight line, you don't need that piece of paper to tell you that it does or doesn't need a wheel alignment. So moving on, we've got the mileage. Again, it's got about 90,000 on the clock. 30,000 less mile than mine's got, so I'm not bothered about that. Got the emissions readout, as long as it passes, put a bottle of Cataclean in it, job's a good one. And again, don't need any of that. Don't need any of that. The only thing, as a mechanic, that I need to know is, has it had a cam belt kit done at 70,000 mile? And honestly, I can't make head nor tail out of any of this, so I'm not too sure. The only way I'm going to find out is have a visual inspection and have a look if the water pump has been replaced. So, this one is from 2018, October. This one is from 2019, October, which is 3-4 months ago. So here, we have all of this. And on the cam belt drive system, it's got a pass. So if we come over, it says cam belt, fitted belt, recommended replacement every 72,000 mile or 86 months. And bear in mind, that's got a pass, and the mileage on this is 86,000. And this one, 2019, the mileage on it is 90,000. Bear in mind, it's got a pass on it. Come down, cam belt fitted, 72,000 mile. Recommended replacement every 60 miles or every month. That doesn't make a blind bit of sense, and the technician that carried it out was Costa. Says it all, really. So Costa, if you're watching this and you work in and out in Warrington, you need your head feeling. So under the engine bay, here is our 1.6 VVT-i petrol engine. You can't really see the water pump or anything like that, so we'll come back to that. It's got an advisory for an oil leak, but it looks like as if it's coming from the top end and dripping down, so that's not going to be a problem. It's not a major sump gasket or anything like that. as we can see, it is all stripped down. I'll come back to that later. Partly why I bought this car, to be honest. It's a lovely dark metallic red. It's been well kept, really. There's not much damage. There's a little bit there where someone tried to... Oh yeah, that's just a bit of... That's a bit of oil or something, eh? Never mind. Colour match trims all the way round. I'm missing that. I'm also missing the aerial. Full glass roof does look nice. Black on red. Got a bloody huge boot. A lot bigger than the Clio. We've got no spare wheel. But apart from that, the jack is on the back seat. In all fairness, it's in very good condition. As we can see, we've got the little sill protectors. We've got little stash boxes everywhere. I'm really impressed with it. So, now time to tell you why I've bought a third car. Why it's all in pieces and how much I got it for and what the significance of this piece of paper is. So the story is, one of my mate's dads bought this car off a woman in Warrington. She couldn't afford to have the starter motor done on it, so she decided to scrap it. My mate's dad then bought it off it, brought it back to theirs, diagnosed it a little bit further, found out it's not the starter motor, and has then come to the conclusion that it's an electrical problem. So hence, the UCH has all been pulled out, the wiring loom through the bulkhead has all been pulled out. This is a second-hand fuse box that has been put on the car, and then I took it off the car, and then put the other one back on, and resolved the issue. Nothing to do with that, I'll get to that further down the line. So my mate's dad tried everything, put a fuse box on it, so when you put the ignition on you couldn't hear the fuel pump, so he's put a permanent live to the fuel pump, got the fuel pump to come in, but obviously that didn't sort it. So what happens, this is a 2008, the car runs a self-test, so you turn the ignition on, the car will do a self-test in the drop of a hat. If the starting conditions are right, it'll then tell the ECU, go ahead, start up. But if there's a signal missing, something like that, the conditions aren't right, it won't start. So I've then said to him, are you selling it? And he said, when I get it going, you can have it for 1500 quid. And I've looked on eBay, they are worth about 15 to 2 grand because it's Elite Mark II with all the creature comforts. So I'll go down a week later, still not fixed it. And he's then said to me, he's not got the time to find out what's up with it. Fair enough, he probably could have fixed it, but he doesn't have the time with work and all stuff like that. So he said to me, I can have it for the money that he's paid for it. So bear in mind, he's had to pay someone for it, then get it back to his, and then put second-hand parts on it, diagnose it, and he's letting it go to me for the price that he's paid. So already, good bargain, and the price he paid was 150 quid. So I'm sat there thinking, 150 quid, it's a 2008 plate. And I went down, I had a little bit of a dabble to try and find out what's up with it. So what was happening was, you could stick the key in, ignition would come on, all of that, but the only thing is the rad fan was permanently running. As soon as you stuck the key in, the rad fan would come on. So I had a little search, found out that it's majority of the time, wasn't in this case, typical, was a power supply issue to the ECU. So I tried everywhere to get a pin out for the ECU, looked on the internet, nowhere had one. Then went to my godfather, luckily enough, he has got an Autodata subscription. So I pinched this off him, as we can see, that's the ECU. That's the car, that's the engine. This is the bit that we needed, the wire side, because we're going to be testing it with the ECU all plugged in. And these are the individual pins that I needed to test, because I've read that if the rad fan is permanently running, power supply issue to the ECU. So as we can see, this is what we've got. 1, 2, 3, ignition on, shut off, battery voltage. And then BD1, the voltage should drop to residual voltage. And again, these three, ignition on, so on and so forth. So picked this up, shot right back down to me mates, started testing, and it all come back fine. And I'm sat there thinking, I've already committed to buying it, I'm not going to be able to fix it. So what I started doing was, as we can see, I've got a wire here. Imagine this is all going to the ECU. Just running my hands over each one like that, picking them up, moving them about. Pick this one up, nothing to do with the power supply to the ECU. I am going to find out which one it is, because I would be curious to find out which wire would cause this issue. So I run my hand over it, and I can feel a little bulge in it. So I spread the wires apart, get down there, have a look, and it's gone blue around the wire. So I thought, bang on, this is it. Give it a little tug, snapped, made up. Cut it, twisted and taped it. The ignition started beeping. Ran round, foot on the clutch, pressed the button, started. So that's how I've ended up with this. £150 bargain. Fixed it outside their house. And now I've just got to put it back together. Possibly a cam belt, a service, and any other bits and bobs I want to do to it really. And then it's going to be a valet, because it is filthy. I mean, there's chips, there's horrible amounts of hair and everything in here. I think that's a Chewy. There's a Chewy on the floor. I've made 20p back already though. So if you like this video, stay tuned for all the follow-up videos that's going to be coming on this. Don't forget to like, don't forget to comment, and of course subscribe so you can catch me in the next one. Thanks for watching. Just realised something as well, I've got 3 red cars. People are going to think I'm as bad as him over there cutting his grass in the rain. Fiesta, Clio, and Megane.